Gopijana Ballabha Girivardhari. Yashodanandana Braj Janaranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braj Janaranjana. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Munatira vanachari. Yamunatira vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Vihari. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Prabhupada. Jaya Prabhupada. Jai Shri Harinam Sankirtan ki jai,
Srila Prabhupada ki jai,
Jayam Vishnupad Paramhansa Parivrajakacharya Stotra Shat Shri Srimad His Divine Grace Abhay Charanarvind Bhakti Vedanta Swami Maharaj Srila Prabhupada ki jai. ISKCON Founder Acharya BBT Sansthapak Acharya Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Anant Koti Vaishnav Bhakt Vrinda ki jai. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Jai Nitai Gaura Premanande. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories, all glories to Sri Sri Guru and Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam namaskritya naram chaiva narottamam devim sarasvatim vyasam tato jayam madhurae nashta prayeshu bhadreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya bhagavati uttama shloke bhaktir bhavati naishthiki. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 23, chapter entitled The Song of the Avanti Brahman, text number 56. Na kenachat. Kenachat kvapi kathanchanasya dvandvoparagaha parataha parasya yathahamaha samsriti rupinaha syad evam prabuddho na bibheti bhutaihi na kenachit kvapi kathanchanasya dvandvoparaga parata parasya yathahamasam sritirupinasya evam prabuddho na bibheti bhutehi na kenachit kvapi kathanchanasya dvandvoparagah paratah parasya yathahama samsriti rupinasyat evam prabuddho na bibheti bhutaihi na kena chatkvapi kathanchanasya dvandvo paraga paratah parasya yathahamasam sritirupinah syad evam prabuddho na bibheti bhuteh. Yatha hama samsmriti rupina syat evam prabhuddho na bubheti bhutehi na kena chitkvapi katha chanasya dvandvo paragah paratah parasya yatha hama samsmriti rupina syat evam prabuddho makena chitkvapi kathanchanasya dvandvo paraga paratah parasya yatha hama samsmriti rupina syat evam prabuddho na bibheti bhute. Mataji. Na kena chitkvapi katha chanasya dvandvo paraga parata parasya yatha hama samsmriti rupina syat evam prabuddho na bibheti bhutehi. Na, there is not, kenachit, by the agency of anyone, kva api, anywhere, kathanchana, by any means, asya, for him, the soul, dvandva, of the duality of happiness and distress. Uparagaha, the influence. Parataha parasya, one who is transcendental to material nature. Yatha, in the same way as. Ahamaha, for the false ego. Samsriti, to material existence. Rupinaha, which gave shape. Syat, arises. Evam, thus. Prabuddhaha, one whose intelligence is awakened. Na bibheti, does not fear bhutehi, on the basis of material creation. Translation: the false ego gives shape to illusory material existence and thus experiences material happiness and distress. The spirit soul, however, is transcendental to material nature and material nature. He can never actually be affected by material happiness and distress in any place, under any circumstance, or by the agency of any person. A person who understands this has nothing whatsoever to fear from the material creation. Purport by the disciples of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. The Brahmana has refuted six specific explanations of the happiness and distress of the living entity, and now he refutes any other explanation that might be given. On the basis of false ego, the bodily covering factually overwhelms the spirit soul, and thus one falsely enjoys and suffers that which has no real relationship with oneself. One who can understand the sublime teaching of the Brahman spoken by the Lord to Uddhava will never again suffer the terrible anxiety of fear within the material world. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuran Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahiyam Dadati Swapadantikam Namam Vishnupadaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschati Deshatarine Vanchakalpatarubhyascha Kripasindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Good morning. Sometimes saying good morning kind of breaks the normal routine, isn't it? It's like, what did they say right now from the Vyasas? And so you kind of wake up. So today, the Vaishnava Brahman or the Vaishnava Sannyasi, this is also how the Avanti Brahman is referred to as. This Vaishnava Sannyasi is trying to make it very clear that ultimately the ownership of any action or the ownership of a particular state of existence has to be established in all honesty. And the matter is very clear. Recently, there are certain statistics which I read about, which may seem interesting to a few of you. It is just the modern world statistics. You know, since the age, the digital age, people have more facilities to count things, put down stats. Sixty 60% of the insect population of the world has disappeared. An entire generation of species have gone. That is what they say. You know, sometimes people put forward this cataclysmic data. Could be true, could be not. A devotee was just 2 days ago driving me, and he's from Nepal. He was telling me that how in Nepal there are 5 special days of puja during the Kartik. And every day the puja is dedicated to various people. One of the days, the puja is, you know, you worship. The worship is dedicated to various. One day you worship the cow, one day you worship the dog, One day you worship the self, the body, everyone gets worshipped. Then there is Lakshmi Puja. And finally there is what is called as, I think, Mahapuja. Or it's the same, the Mahapuja is the same as where every single member of the family does abhishek of every other member of the family with flower petals. It's a traditional festival. And it's being lost. And on the day that, and then we got into a conversation where it was like, how our ancestors, like just the grandparents, he said he grew up seeing his parents, that generation, always serve the first servings of any meal. The first servings of any meal, they would serve either the birds or the animals. I mean, in today's times, that's really a very lost practice. I'll give you some data, and we'll come to a certain conclusion, hopefully. And one of the servings of such a meal was to the crows. And there is definite links between the crow and the existence of people trees. Wherever there are no crows, you won't find any people trees growing there. Now you know how important people trees were to the ancient culture that was prevalent in India. In fact, if you go to Prabhas Kshetra, there is the belief that Lord Krishna, he spent his final moments of his revealed pastimes under the peepal tree. In fact, in old India, people still believe that the peepal tree represents Lord Krishna. And science now believes that the peepal tree is one of those few species that gives you maximum oxygen. No crows. So entire species are dwindling. In the past 40 to 50 years, the rate at which cities have expanded is immense. What is the present population of Mumbai, anyone knows? Mumbai, not the greater Mumbai, maybe just Mumbai. 2 crores. It's about 2 crores, right? The population of Pune is almost 1 crore now. The number of vehicles on the streets in Pune that are registered last year was 64 lakhs. Registered vehicles. There are more vehicles on the roads than ants nowadays. China, there was a small village called as, forget the name, Shenzhen or something like that. Today the population of that village, which is one of the big sprawling cities, is 20 million. That city combined with, the city has expanded into surrounding cities, it has merged with surrounding 9 cities. The total population of those 9 cities is 60 million. Here in the purport, the commentators are writing, on the basis of false ego, the bodily covering factually overwhelms the spirit soul, and thus one falsely enjoys and suffers that which has no real relationship with oneself. And then we say that, oh, the climate is changing, we have rains coming in December now. So what is this false ego? Can we just philosophize about it? Is the false ego only to be addressed when we are sitting down and chanting our rounds? Is the false ego to be addressed 2 hours in the morning, 2 hours in the afternoon, 2 hours in the evening? Because essentially it is based on the false ego that one kind of imagines certain happiness and certain distress, suffering in this world, which has no relationship with the self, with the real self. Nevada is a desert, and right now, even in Rajasthan, the kind of energy resources that are being drawn is making the neighboring country a little anxious, because they are thinking it's on the border, right? So there's a recent statement by one of their scientists from the neighboring country that, is India taking away underground resources? Because underground channels know no borders. Nevada is a desert. I mean, practically, an entire huge city in Arizona has thousands of airplanes dumped with people having no idea how to recycle them. Do you know how many trains we have in our yards? The port of Chittagong in Bangladesh has hundreds of ships waiting to be torn down. There isn't enough labor to do that. The kind of excesses that we are going into nowadays. I mean, it is normal for any individual to have at least 2 cell phones. Does this have any connection with the real self? Let me tell you a story from 1,000 years ago, maybe 1,500 years ago. A general of a very powerful army had come to have an audience with a renounced person, very renounced person. How renounced was this person? This person would stay lying on the ground and would not move at all. Where in the Bhagavatam have we heard this? Seventh, sixth, eighth. Where in the Bhagavatam have we heard of a person who's so renounced that simply is lying on the ground, doesn't move at all? What vritti is it called as? Ajagar vritti. Or in today's times it would be ajgar vritti. You know, python after eating doesn't move. The only difference is these people do not eat. Still they do not move. And they have some typical poses with which they are lying on the ground. It is not like shavasana like we do. Now, sometimes when we lie down in the holy dhams, we are like looking at the sky and enjoying it, and we are like thinking ajagar vritti. They have certain yogic poses. These postures are extremely uncomfortable. To be able to understand this in present day times, when you go to certain holy places, we can go into certain, go off the parikrama mark. And you'll find people doing strange practices, like severe austerities. And looking at their austerities, it would kind of, for us, it would seem immaterial whether we eat or we do not eat on Ekadashi. Severe austerities. So this person was lying on the ground in this very intense posture, unmoving. The only fact that the person was alive was, the person was breathing, his body was effulgent, his eyes were sparkling clear and looked very intelligent. This general of this army had come from a faraway place, from halfway across the world, and he had come with a message. Our king, who is the son of God, because in those days kings were treated to be the sons of the Supreme. Our king, who is the son of God, has asked you to come and see him. If you come and visit him and have a discussion, you will be suitably rewarded. If you do not accept his invitation, you might be beheaded. The person did not even move. He just answered in a clear voice. If your king is the son of God, so am I. And so are all living entities. Because God is the source of all. And how does your king claim to be the king when the king is still subjugated to the king of death? Do you think your king can ask the king of death to come and have an audience with him? Or will the king have to go to have an audience with death? We are simple Brahmins. These were the words used 1500 years ago. We are simple Brahmins. These texts are not found in the regular Puranas. This goes to show the extent of the culture that existed. God being the supreme does not resort to violence. In fact, God gives food, water, light, and life. Your king is resorting to violence. Your king does not give all of these facilities to all. I answer to God, not to anyone else. As far as seeking of rewards, we are not interested in wealth. And as far as death is concerned, we know death is inevitable, and it is ultimately giving up of an old garment. After death, the soul shall reach God, the Supreme Creator. So please tell the king, if he wants, he can come here. But I am not obliged to go and meet the king out of fear of death or out of greed of wealth. The king went to meet this ascetic sage, and they had a discussion on philosophy. The king revered him, was very respectful, and the king left. This king was Alexander the Great. And the sage that he met was called as, in Greek writings, is called as Dandamish. And in those writings, they state that when they had come to northern India in those days, when they had crossed over the Hindu Kush mountains, traveled across what is present-day Afghanistan and Iran, and they had reached the plains of the Indus, the Satluj, and they had as yet not reached the Ganga, that army. They had come to They had come face to face with hundreds of such ascetics, hundreds of them. And when this army met these hundreds of ascetics, all these ascetics were so unconcerned. There was no fear. There was no aggression in them. All they did was stamp their feet on the ground, all of them. So the general, he kind of felt it weird. What kind of custom is this? What is this custom? So they made truce. They kind of, the army said, we should not harm these people. They look to be very renounced, ascetic people. They asked them, why were you, what is this custom that you have, stamping your feet on the ground? And they said, this is not a custom. This is a message we want to give to you. This earth is no one's property. And all you need is that much space as your 2 feet occupy on this earth. You are trying to conquer territories and lay claim over it. Well, you may try that, but very soon you will be dead, and then you will realize that actually what you need is just sufficient space in the earth to lay down your dead body. That is it. So this message is being given here in this verse. The previous verse spoke about graha, kal, devata and all those things. Anything else that the fertile mind can come up with could be the cause of why I am where I am is being refuted in this verse. And it is not just the Bhagavatam, this is a culture that prevailed. And that is why this culture is so very brilliantly shining through the pages of the Bhagavatam. Today the expansionist idea is increasing so much. Previously, let's go to some of the chawls that still exist. One room, 10 members. Today, 10 rooms, 2 members. Expansionist. Where does it come from? It comes from the false conception of the self. The self being the idea that we are the most advanced species. Humans are the most intelligent because they can think, they can understand spiritual life. Hence, all I speak about is how I revere cows. But we are least concerned about whether the cows have their space or not. Why is that? Here it is being stated. On the basis of false ego, the bodily covering factually overwhelms the spirit soul. Overwhelms. You see the kind of data that we have accumulated on the subconscious mind is so much of spam. And we don't even delete it. It is so much data on a hard drive that our hard drives are practically slowing down. Everyone speaks of the good old days. In the good old days when I joined, in the good old days when I first came to Krishna consciousness, nothing was there. This was just a small place. Today, none of us have the ability to live in a small place. We feel so very suffocated to live in a small place. Can we imagine living 1 week in a small place in some remote corner of India? No.
We don't have the ability anymore to do that. We need to communicate. It's not just the verbal communication has taken a back seat. It's more of digital communication. We feel more comfortable expressing our false ego on the social media platform. And social media is this new realm that gives facility for the false ego to grow and grow and grow. Just look at the number of messages that we put out on digital media. Yes, no, thank you, great, likes. And obviously, there is the philosophy that whatever can be used in service of the Supreme Lord should be used. That's correct. There's so much being used in the service of the Supreme Lord that traditional ways of serving the Lord are slowly becoming extinct. Dvandva paragaha parataha parasya. Parataha parasya, for one who is transcendental. That is how it is being translated here. Para means above, para means better, para means that which is higher than this. That is para. So parataha parasya. Okay, that makes sense. Dvandva uparagaha. Dvandva, the duality is uparahaga, the influence. If we see the most referenced pastime from the Srimad Bhagavatam, if we look into it once again today, Prahlad Maharaj and Hiranyakashipu. Just because Prahlad became influential at school, Shandanamarka come back and report to Hiranyakashipu that your son is uncontrollable. In fact, he has converted everyone at school. Everyone at school is inquiring about Lord Vishnu. The first thought that comes in Hiranyakashipu's mind, the first thought is that Prahlad is the killer of my brother. Because he is following Lord Vishnu and not subjugating himself to my instructions, he is the killer of my brother. Where does one get such thoughts coming in our mind? Can we imagine, this is Hiranyakashipu, but let us take that as being instructive. Can we imagine the kind of spam that we have in our subconscious mind? The kind of data, past impressions that we have accumulated that immediately makes us feel that a person who has just influenced one school can be called the killer of one's brother. And this is the Bhagavatam. Maybe the Bhagavatam is very edited, all right? And that is what makes it very interesting. It's very dramatic, maybe. Maybe it is not chronological. Maybe this is not what happened to Hiranyakashipu, all right. Maybe today Hiranyakashipu thought that Prahlad is the killer. Maybe 5 days from now he thought something else. It's quite possible. We'll give it that. Although the Bhagavatam does not say whether it was in 5 days or 1 day. But what is the kind of processing that is going on in his mind? Just look at the kind of processing, the justification that he has. This is what the dualities of the material world do to us. They give us so much data, so much information, so many impressions that when the initial enthusiasm goes away and we become too familiar with the process, then the mind starts tricking us in so many ways, and now those tricks, they kind of come covered up as our lawyers. They are advocates. They advocate the false ego that we want to portray in the form of justification. Hiranyakashipu says, just as sometimes a medicinal herb in the forest being beneficial is respected and protected, although the herb is not even from the human species, still we accept it as very dear because it helps you, it is medicinal. Similarly, a person may not be a member of your family, maybe from outside your family, but if that person is favorable to you, that person should be protected as a family member. On the other hand, if one of your limbs becomes gangrenous, infected beyond repair, then one cuts it off, although the limb belongs to your own body. Similarly, if your son or family member becomes unfavorable to you, then one should reject or even kill that son. This is a justification he's bringing to his, into his mind to convince himself how he can kill Prahlad. Why? Because Prahlad became influential at one school. I mean, Hiranyakashipu, he had a franchise of schools. But he justified himself. He was so insecure. He was so unsure of his own stand. He justifies, like, this Prahlad, he's untrustworthy. Why? Because at 5 years of age, he is going against his own parents. Which child does that? I mean, look at any child. You give them a lollipop, they forget their parents. This is common understanding. Statistically, a child can be easily deluded. But look at his reasoning. At 5 years of age, this person is rejecting his own parents who love him so much. What is the guarantee that he will even be loyal to Lord Vishnu? Untrustworthy fellow. Now, if we did not understand how analogies should work, this seems to be a good analogy. But analogies only work when the comparison is equitable. It has to be on equal terms. And then he is using another justification. Just as uncontrolled senses become the enemy of a yogi, Hiranyakashipu is considering himself to be a yogi and Prahlad to be his uncontrolled mind. Now, how philosophical is that? What a misrepresentation of philosophy is that? And Hiranyakashipu is Dr. PhD, you know, obviously he knows all the scriptures because he praised Lord Brahma, got boons from Lord Brahma. We are not even able to access the 1000th generation of Brahma. This person accessed Brahma himself. He justified that within his mind to absolve himself of any envy, to absolve himself of any wrongdoing. And he made Prahlad the culprit. Now, Bhagavatam obviously is a little different because these are stories of the most surrendered souls. So we see that Lord Narsingadev is going to come and protect him. What is very interesting is the conversation that happened before Lord Narasimha's appearance. Hiranyakashipu asks him, my authority is such that even the demigods did tremble at the mention of my name. And you at 5 years of age, You're standing here completely unperturbed where I'm so angry. Where do you get your strength from? And Prahlad gives him some philosophy, and Hiranyakashipu, his philosophy is, my dear father, you are my father. Why do I do not have anything to fear from you? Prahlad is expressing a normal human emotion. It is not even philosophy. Now he gives philosophy. He says, fear only arises when we consider somebody to be our friend and someone to be our enemy. Hiranyakashipu is a typical person who is using so many different avenues to prove that he is emotionally exploited. Prahlad is the perfect person who's supposed to be like those ascetics, you know, like the one, Dandamish, that met Alexander. No justification for one's own self. He says, my dear father, many people in the past who have made differentiation between friends and enemies have always suffered. And the reason they consider somebody to be the friend and somebody to be their enemy is because they feel they are powerful. And why do they feel they are powerful? Only people who are powerful, they make discriminations. Garib aadmi kya bhed karega bhai? Batao na aap. A poverty-stricken person, why would he discriminate between high and low? Only a powerful person does that. You, I think, you can only be having so much, so you are in this category, you are in the other category. Power does that to you. They consider themselves to be powerful because they think they have conquered all the 10 directions, but they have not even conquered their 6 enemies within the heart. And Hiranyakashipu gets so angry. 5 saal ka bach, 5 years old. You are talking about conquering the 6 enemies. 10,000 years of tapasya kiya hai maine. 10,000 years I subjugated myself to severe austerities. I conquered my mind. I conquered my senses. I conquered all the negativities. Brahmaji certified me. 10,000 saal ka maine kiya. Tune kya kiya 5 saal mein? You are talking about conquering the 6 enemies. You are talking to me. Now I understand that you are either over intelligent or you are a fool. You simply want to have received death at my hands, and so shall I give it to you. The false ego is very, very interesting. It is the one thing that eludes you even when you have completely understood it. Because a false ego cannot be ascertained by understanding. The only way to challenge it and to be free from it is to serve menially. It's strange. Service menially is the intrinsic quality of the spirit soul. Social media never allows the spirit soul to come out of it. Social media is a platform of so much facility for self-glorification. And I'm not speaking just about YouTube where you make presentations. I'm just speaking about the compulsion where you need to comment on somebody else's comment. Happy anniversary. 10 likes to that. The compulsion that's there. And I asked some people, why do you do that? And they said, because they will feel hurt if you don't do that. And I'm like, wow. Hiranyakashipu really felt hurt by Prahlad. Mera bachcha. Mera khoon. Maine itna prem kiya usse. Mujhse gaddari. Are Vishnu ka bhi kya hoga ye? I In today's courts, if Hiranyakashipu were gone, he would have given so many reasons as to how Prahlad is not a good son. The false ego. One who can understand the sublime teaching of the Brahmana spoken by the Lord to Uddhava will never again suffer. So there's so much that we have talked. Very short, because this is a recent story and I thought I should share it with you. It's a very common story, but maybe some of you have not heard about it. There's a beautiful temple in North Kerala where Lord Shiva is worshipped along with Mother Parvati, but it is basically Lord Shiva. The town is Kottiyur. And one of the ways that, and Lord Shiva is only worshipped for a few days in the entire year. Rest of the year, it's similar to, in certain ways, similar to the Gundicha temple. Like 7 to 8 days, there's a lot of activity at the temple. Other days, the temple is empty, the Gundicha temple. So this temple of Lord Shiva. Many, many years ago, a devotee of the name Punthanam had come there. There are so many various ways this name is pronounced that typically you can, depends on whatever you want to call. It's a story from hundreds of years ago. Had come to read the Srimad Bhagavatam at that place, reading 10th canto, 60th chapter, Krishna Rukmini Samvad. Just read it. And then he would continue. Come read that. So every day read one chapter. That was the schedule. The next day when he comes, he sees that the bookmark is still at the 60th chapter, the beginning of the 60th chapter. So he reads the Samvad again. The next day he comes, it's the same thing. For the entire period that he was there, and he was so simple-hearted, he's like, maybe this is what I should read. Maybe the people want me to read. Maybe the locals, they just kept the bookmark there. Maybe this is a tradition. Did not make any inquiry. Was happy reading the same chapter again and again and again. So the last day, he reads the same chapter, leaves the temple, and on the way out, halfway through to his residence, he realizes, hey, I forgot my Bhagavatam in the temple. He goes back. The temple is completely empty. It is closed. So he looks for certain ways to get into the temple to get his Bhagavatam. Old days, people kind of know temples have ways to get in, right? And then he sees something interesting. He sees someone who looks like Lord Shiva sitting and reading the Bhagavatam loudly. And there is this beautiful lady whom he is addressing as Devi. He reads the entire chapter and his voice is so melodious, it is so soothing that Punthanam sits right there listening to that rendition. At the end of it, the person who looks like Lord Shiva says, Devi, did you like my rendition? Did you like me reading this? She said, I loved it. However, Punthanam's reading was more endearing to the heart. And Lord Shiva says, indeed it was. And that is why every day I would put the bookmark at the beginning of this chapter. I love this episode, and his way of reading the Bhagavatam was very, very dear to me. So this is the month of book distribution. It is also the month where we distribute books, and we realize that we have to, for the next 11 months, introspect how that the message of the books is being received by the self. So, one of the ways that menial service is done is being able to enjoy reading the Srimad Bhagavatam. Not just understanding it, studying it, but being able to enjoy reading the Srimad Bhagavatam. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any questions or comments? Granthara Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.